Good afternoon. We will go ahead and get started here in just a minute. So thank you very much for joining us. And again, we'll get started here in just one moment. Again, for those just joining us, thank you for taking the time today. We'll be going ahead and get starting in just a moment. Great. In the interest of time, why don't we go ahead and get started? And so first and foremost, good afternoon or good morning for those on the West Coast. My name is Tim Daly, a senior program officer here at the Joyce Foundation. And thank you for joining today's discussion in our Lunch and Learn webinar series on emerging research into gun violence. For today's discussion, we are joined by two leading thinkers from Johns Hopkins University to discuss their new research published in the American Journal of Public Health on background check laws and firearms licensing. Before we dig into the details of today's discussion, just a few quick housekeeping items. Today's webinar is being recorded, and in the coming days, we will make that available on the Joyce Foundation's website. And after today's discussion, we will share the presenter's slide deck and other key materials referenced in today's webinar. Again, the schedule for today's webinar is that the session will last 1 hour, with the final 30 minutes being reserved for your questions. And to that end, if you have a question for today's speakers, please include it in the Q&A feature found at the bottom of your screen. I would encourage you to submit your question as you think of them, even if the speakers are still presenting. With that housekeeping aside, let's jump into today's discussion. In recent years, the Joyce Foundation has supported research to better understand the impact of firearm background check policies. This research comes amid substantial attention by policymakers and advocates on universal background checks as a critical component of an evidence-informed policy response to gun violence. Importantly, we have learned through this research that not all background checks policies are the same, and how these laws are designed and implemented makes a huge difference in their overall effectiveness. One of the components of background check policies that research is now finding to be particularly effective is firearms licensing, or also known as permit to purchase in some states. To discuss this issue further, we're pleased to be joined by two researchers whose work has largely shaped the public's understanding of firearm licensing policies, Drs. Daniel Webster and Cass Crifasi. Dr. Webster is the director of the Johns Hopkins Center for Gun Violence Prevention and Policy and co-director of the Johns Hopkins Center for Prevention of Youth Violence. Over the last decade, Dr. Webster has produced numerous articles on firearm policy, the prevention of gun violence, intimate partner violence, and youth violence prevention. Dr. Cass Crifasi is an assistant professor at the Johns Hopkins University Department of Health Policy and Management and is the deputy director of the Hopkins Center for Gun Violence Prevention and Policy. Her research focuses broadly on public safety, including injury epidemiology and prevention, gun violence and policy, attitudes and behaviors of gun owners, and underground gun markets. So with that, Drs. Webster and Crifasi, the floor is yours.
Great, thanks, Tim. Happy to be here. Let me just pull up our slides. Okay, look good? Good, okay, perfect. All right, so I'm going to start off with a little bit of an overview about the federal background check system and state level private sale laws, what we know about them. And then I'm going to talk about how firearm licensing systems or purchaser licensing laws complement these systems. I'm going to talk about some of the work we've done in Maryland, evaluating its relatively new law. And then I'm going to kick it over to Daniel, who's going to talk about some of the research we've done in other states, including Connecticut and Missouri, other studies that have looked at the impact of gun laws, including the mass shootings and other topics. And then he'll talk about some of our public opinion work and some future considerations. So I just want to start off by making sure sort of all on the same page when we're talking about the federal background check system and state level private sales laws. So When somebody wants to buy a gun from a gun store or other licensed dealer, that seller is required under federal law to conduct a background check using the National Instant Criminal Background Check System, or NICS. They use the purchaser's name, date of birth, gender, to check the background before they make the sale. After running this background check, one of three things happens. The seller can be immediately alerted that the sale can proceed, or the sale can be immediately denied if the check comes back and the purchaser is prohibited. Or this third thing can happen, which is that the sale could be delayed if there's more time needed to check the purchaser's background. If it is delayed, law enforcement has only 3 days to conduct an additional review of records to determine if the purchaser is prohibited. If it can't be resolved in 3 days, the default under federal law is that the seller can complete the sale to that purchaser, even if they may be prohibited. And then in the future, if the background check comes back and that person shouldn't have had a firearm, law enforcement then has to go and take that gun away from the purchaser. And this happens on average between 4,000 and 5,000 times every year. So there are some challenges that exist in the federal system. So states and government agencies, even we've learned federal agencies, don't always report records in a timely manner. And this is true whether we're thinking about criminal records or mental health records. And this can create gaps where prohibited individuals could inappropriately gain access to firearms and then may use them to harm themselves or others if we're only relying on the federal system. The use of name and birthday checks on their own has the potential to miss at least 10% of prohibiting conditions. And it's important to keep in mind also that people who may commit violence don't always have a prohibiting condition that might keep them from purchasing a gun. Federal law, as we know, has no requirement for background checks to be conducted by private sellers. Sellers can't knowingly sell to someone who's prohibited, but if the seller doesn't ask and the buyer doesn't tell, then there's really no way for the seller to know if the purchaser is eligible without having conducted a background check. Although we do know that even in some cases where the purchaser has indicated that they can't pass a background check, there are still some private sellers who will go forward with that sale. So 21 states and the District of Columbia have filled this gap in federal law by requiring that private sellers conduct background checks. But these laws are subject to many of the same weaknesses that the federal system has because of the gaps that I described. And so the best research that we have available right now that looks at change over time in these policies has not found protective effects for requiring background checks for private sales in the absence of a licensing system. So this is due in part to some of these challenges, but it's also compounded by weak or limited enforcement and also poor compliance. So one solution that we've spent time researching is requiring handgun purchaser licensing, also sometimes called firearm purchaser licensing or permit to purchase, as Tim mentioned. These laws require that someone, for example, who wants to buy a handgun, must apply for and obtain a license from state or local law enforcement. So there are a few key parts of licensing systems that we think make them more effective than private sales background checks on their own. So first, as part of the process, applicants have to submit an application to law enforcement that includes a photograph. Sometimes they have a photograph taken, sometimes it's from their driver's license, and they often have to submit fingerprints to facilitate the background check. The use of fingerprints is important because it increases the likelihood that someone who has a prohibiting condition will be properly identified and screened out from purchasing a firearm. Otherwise, there are too many opportunities to miss a prohibiting condition with a name and birthday alone. In fact, that's why most occupational licensure processes require fingerprints. So one high profile example, the shooting in Aurora, Illinois, that individual was prohibited, but that prohibiting condition was missed when he applied for his firearm owner's identification card as part of his background check. But when he applied for a concealed carry license, he submitted fingerprints to expedite that application. And at that point, with the fingerprint-based background check, he was actually flagged as prohibited. He was sent a letter to relinquish his guns and his FOID card, but he failed to do so. And we know that he used those firearms to commit a mass shooting at his former workplace. So this just is an example of how not using a fingerprint-based background check could create missed opportunities. So the second component is that law enforcement has more time to complete a background check. So it varies across states, but on average, it's about 30 days to make sure they can check the records. This gives them plenty of time to make sure that a purchaser is not prohibited. This additional time is really important to make sure that records aren't missed. So for example, again, another high profile example, the fact that a background check could not be completed in 3 days is what allowed the Charleston church shooter to obtain a firearm even though he was prohibited. So that extra time can be really important to make sure that people who have prohibiting conditions don't get firearms. Also, we like to think of that additional time as a way to delay impulsive acquisition where someone might be wanting to get a firearm with the purpose of harming themselves or others. And when we think about in comparison to the federal background check system, state and local law enforcement have access to records that might not yet have been reported into the NICS system yet, right? There may be delays in the time that it takes cities or counties or even states to report into the federal system. And so having access to local records can better identify and screen out people who shouldn't have access to firearms with that additional time available. So the last thing I'll say about these purchaser licensing systems is related to accountability and sort of the way that you can enforce the law. So if you're in a state with one of these systems, purchasers have to show a valid license to every seller, whether it's licensed or private, before they purchase a gun. And this is an important piece for accountability because if I sell a handgun in a private sale to someone who doesn't have a license and that gun is then recovered in crime, it's easier to prove that I violated the law because that person was not an eligible purchaser without a license, even if they aren't prohibited, right? So there's an extra layer of accountability there. So there's some variation that we see across states regarding purchaser licensing laws, whether the application has to occur in person, for how long the license lasts, fingerprinting, things like that. But the sort of core components that we think about are an application to state or local law enforcement and more time to conduct a more thorough background check. So in contrast to private sale background checks alone, there's actually a large body of research demonstrating the effectiveness of these purchaser licensing laws on a range of outcomes. So I'll transition to talk about some of the work we've done in Maryland as an example. So Maryland passed a Firearm Safety Act in 2013. There were several components to this law, including the requirement that prospective handgun purchasers get what we call a handgun qualification license, or you know, the permit to purchase. It requires a fingerprint facilitated background check and also safety training for people who hadn't previously owned handguns. Given that the law was a relatively recent change in 2013, we wanted to start our evaluation of Maryland's law by looking at sort of more intermediate outcomes like diversion, for example. So two key points before I jump into the data. So most guns that are recovered in crime take a pretty long time to get there. So the national time to crime is about 8 years. So when a gun is recovered quickly within 1 year of retail sale, that's an indicator that the gun was purchased with the intent to divert that gun for use in crime. And it's an even stronger indicator when the person who used the gun in crime was not the person who originally purchased it. So the first study that we looked at, we looked at handguns that were recovered in Baltimore City within 1 year of retail sale, and the purchaser was not the possessor. So these are guns originally sold in the state of Maryland. And we found that the licensing law was associated with a 76% reduction in handguns that were recovered with these strong indicators of diversion. So substantially fewer guns recovered with short time to crime, or someone using the gun was not the person who bought it. If you look at the pre-law period, so 2010 up through 2013, the law took effect in October 2013, so we can sort of include 2013 in that, and you compare it to the post period 2014 to 2018, for short time to crime guns that were recovered in Maryland, Pennsylvania, and Virginia, you see Pennsylvania didn't really change all that much. Virginia experienced a 7% increase in recoveries of short time to crime guns. But in contrast, overall during the post period, Maryland saw an 18% decrease in recoveries of these short time to crime guns. Additionally, if you look at the proportion of all guns that were recovered in Maryland that originated in a retail sale within the state, the proportion of those guns dropped significantly after the law changed, such that now more guns that are recovered in crime in Maryland are coming from other states. So I'll share one more piece of data from our Maryland work. So we also wanted to get a sense, right? We're looking at the diversion of guns that are being recovered in crime. So we wanted to get a sense from people involved in the underground gun market of what their perspectives were. So we surveyed nearly 200 men on parole and probation in Baltimore City about their experiences with the underground gun market and specifically about their perceptions around the licensing law, our handgun qualification license. 40% said the law made it harder to get a gun. They were more costly when they were available. A third said that people were less likely to engage in a straw purchase because now you had to get a license and that was sort of an extra deterrent or an extra hurdle. And a quarter said it was harder to find trusted suppliers. So when we look at all of these data points together, it suggests to us that Maryland's licensing law constrained the local sources of guns for use in crime, which is really consistent with prior research. So I am going to turn it over now to Daniel to talk about some of the other work that we've done. And Daniel, you should now have control.
Great, thank you, Cass. So I'm gonna shift, there we go, it is moving. All right. So I want to talk about a study that we recently completed that was led by Dr. Alex McCourt, who directs legal research for our center. It was, in essence, a comparison of laws being changed, some focused on licensing and some with comprehensive background check requirements without licensing. All of these laws focus specifically on handguns. So the licensing law changes were Connecticut, going back all the way to 1995. In Connecticut, required you needed a fingerprint-based verification of your identity, 8 hours of safety training, of course, in-person application with law enforcement. Missouri changed its law in August of 2007 for going back all the way to the 1920s that they had a requirement that you get a permit to purchase a handgun from your local sheriff's office. So when they repealed this law back in 2007, it simultaneously negated both the permitting requirement, but also importantly, the comprehensive background check requirement. So these requirements in both of these states apply to all handgun transfers, whether from licensed dealers or not. For some reason it's not advancing. Oh, here we go. So, Cass showed you what we found in Maryland when they adopted a handgun purchaser licensing law, and we saw this indicator of short time to crime go down very suddenly and dramatically. When Missouri repealed its law in 2007, in essence, you see the opposite. You see a twofold increase in this short time to crime indicator. Again, sort of the mirror opposite of what we saw in Maryland. When Missouri repealed its law, you see more and more of the guns recovered in crime originated within the state. All of these signs are pointing to guns very quickly moving from a legal transaction to illegal criminal use. Now, if you look at the firearm homicide rate in Missouri, you see an abrupt change, an abrupt increase in the first annual data point after the repeal of their licensing law. And you compare that to the national trends or even the regional trends, there's a clear departure there. Now, in 2019, led by researchers at Penn's Wharton School, we looked at the effect of this change in Missouri with more data points than a prior study that we had using what we call a bracketing method. And I'll just mention that briefly. Here in this graph from the article, you'll see Missouri in sort of the heavy dark line at the top of the graph, and compared to other control states in the region that had similarly high rates. And you see a departure with Missouri going up more rapidly than its the control states in that region. So in the bracketing, we contrast across a range of different states, depending on how closely they match the baseline rates in Missouri. And we generated these estimates ranging from a 16 or 17% increase to a 27% increase. Again, I think with the best controls, it correlated with a 27% estimated increase in firearm homicide rates. Cass already mentioned this part, so I'm going to move forward and talk about the study that Alex McCourt led and was published a couple of months ago, where we're contrasting these changes in Missouri and Connecticut with changes in comprehensive background check requirements for handgun transfers in Pennsylvania and Maryland right around the same time that Connecticut's law went into effect. We used a synthetic control method for estimating what the counterfactual would be, our estimate of what would have happened had these laws not changed. This is a method that's being used more and more to minimize our prediction error. And I'll show you a little bit from our models, hopefully to convince you that the models fit quite well, actually. So we control for a variety of things. The covariates are at the bottom of the slide there, relevant to law enforcement measures, incarceration, rates of robbery, income inequality, and so on. This is a graph. The solid line reflects firearm homicide rates in Connecticut, and the dotted line is the synthetic control estimate for Connecticut. And what you'll see is that prior to the law, relatively a close match of their rates, and then things start to change with Connecticut's going consistently lower, except for a couple of data points around 2012. You also see a similar pattern, but even clearer when you look at firearm suicide rates in Connecticut in comparison to the synthetic control. And you know, researchers, you might want to note how closely this model prediction is during the baseline period. That's kind of what we're looking for, is a close correlation during that time period. And then you see a clear departure afterwards. This is Missouri's rates, again, in the dark line here in the synthetic control and then dotted comparison. Again, you see fairly close comparison prior to the law change and then a clear departure afterwards. I should note that we stopped, our last data point is 2016 because in 2017 is when Missouri went to permitless carry and we didn't want that to confound our estimate. Here's the same sort of metric, but with firearm suicides, comparing Missouri in its synthetic control. You do see a little bit of departure in the year prior to the law change, which makes me not too happy, but clearly you see an upward trend that it goes more and more departs from the prediction in the model. So this table just summarizes the estimates for the relevant outcomes. We looked at gun homicide and non-gun homicide and gun suicide and non-gun suicide to see whether the estimated effects were particular to what they should be, which is deaths connected to firearms. In the Connecticut example, we estimate a 28% reduction in firearm homicide rates connected to that law change, no change at all in non-gun homicide rates. And as a way to indicate something somewhat equivalent to a p-value of how unusual the changes are relevant to other states that did not adopt a licensing law, again, highly significant there. With Missouri, we have fewer comparison points, but clearly a large increase, an estimated 47% increase. Now we did also see an increase in non-gun homicide rates, suggesting that there may be other social influences that may be elevating homicides generally that may be partly confound our estimates. But it's worth noting that about a 2.5 times as high of an estimate for gun homicides as opposed to non-gun homicides. For suicides, very similar pattern here. In Connecticut, you had a little bit of a confounding situation in that something that is a sort of a precursor to extreme risk protection order laws that gave law enforcement power to remove guns when people were threatening to do bad things, including suicide. The implementation of that started to ramp up in 2007. So we generated a separate estimate that was slightly lower, but not too much lower. So anywhere between 23% decline and 33% decline in gun suicides associated with that law change, and a 24% increase in Missouri's gun homicide rates or suicide rates. It's actually worth noting because gun suicides in these states are more common than gun homicides, that when you total up the impact in preventable deaths, it's actually a bigger effect on suicides. What about in the states that extended background checks to private transfers of handguns, but without licensing? Well, in Maryland and Pennsylvania, we actually saw increases in gun homicide rates following these laws. Now, when we broke things down in Maryland, we saw that most of this effect of increases following the change in the law was very specific to Baltimore City and was not observed in other parts of the state, suggesting that perhaps the onset of the law was associated with other factors going on specific to Baltimore City. Now, we looked similarly to see whether that was going on in the Pennsylvania case, but we did not see evidence that it was something only peculiar, say, to Philadelphia, for example. So anyway, we're clearly not seeing protective effects on gun homicides, nor on gun suicides. You do see for Maryland a 15% lower rate of gun suicide associated with the law, but you also see an actually even slightly higher rate 4 declines in non-gun suicide, suggesting that, again, you might have some other factor that's explaining that. So what are the limitations of this study? Well, with any interrupted time series type of study, you're always vulnerable to some historical confounding. I note the Baltimore Uprising, actually, that's not connected in this particular study. We truncated our analysis because of that. But it could unrest connected to the Ferguson, things going on in Ferguson, Missouri in 2014 could potentially affect the Missouri estimates. Although I have to say, you see these increases in gun homicides throughout the state. So other studies, I'm just going to very briefly mention, because I think it's actually quite important, the consistency in what we're seeing across so many different outcomes. We published a study earlier this year looking at effective state gun laws on fatal mass shootings. Purchaser licensing laws clearly had the strongest and most consistent protective effect in all of our models, a fairly large protective effect. We also, in work published 5 years ago that CAST led, we saw that these laws were associated with rates of law enforcement officers being shot in the line of duty. In the case of Connecticut, a large reduction in being officers shot with handguns, and in Missouri, increases in officers being shot both fatally and non-fatally. Last data point I'm just going to show, and this is really preliminary work, but it's rather striking. If you look at the data that we have for fatal shootings by law enforcement officers, you see the same pattern that you see in almost any other kind of firearm-related mortality of substantially lower rates in states that have purchaser licensing laws. When you contrast it with neither comprehensive background check or not, the rates in states with licensure are about 1/4 that they are in those other states, and about half as high of states that have comprehensive background checks without licensing laws. Oh, I realize, okay, I'll just say briefly, public opinion. There's very strong support, of course, for comprehensive background checks, but also for purchaser licensing. We found about a little over 75% of adults support this policy, 62% of gun owners, and something that CAST published is showing that if you were a gun owner in states with purchaser licensing, over 3/4 supported these laws, strong support among African Americans as well. Future work is more in-depth studies on association between purchaser licensing and fatal police violence, examination of effects on racial groups and youth, and also importantly, what impact these laws have on arrests and incarceration and racial disparities.
Great. Thank you, Daniel and Cass, for that very, very enlightening presentation. I appreciate that. Why don't we jump into the questions? Again, as a reminder, if you have a question, please include it in the Q&A box that you find at the bottom of the screen. And one housekeeping item, a question was asked, will we be sharing the slide deck after today? Yes, we will be sure to share the slide deck and any other materials that come up during the balance of our Q&A discussion. So with that, let's jump into the first question, if you don't mind. The question, I think, goes to the heart of the matter here. And the viewer asks, does this mean that background checks by themselves are not effective at reducing homicide and suicide? And I'll defer to you all on who would like to go first.
I'll take a stab at that. So we've yet to see in studies that decouple the effects of comprehensive background checks from licensing laws and the analyses. Now there's frankly, some differences in how researchers have coded the laws. But when they cover, when the coding includes laws that just look at handguns and not all guns, the pattern has been remarkably clear. We're not seeing a protective effects without licensing as of yet. It's worth noting that many of the law changes that we had to study go way back to the 1990s when our background check systems were really quite weak, a lot of missing records. So there's ongoing work looking at more recent studies, and we're slightly more hopeful, but we do think that there's good reason to believe that a simply requiring background checks without more robust measures like licensing are unlikely to have large effect, at least on fatal outcomes. We don't know about non-fatal outcomes.
Great, thank you. Next question, is it safe to assume that the additional cool down time for a permit to purchase is the central mechanism for impact, given that most prohibiting events are nonviolent offenses with big racial disparities, like drug possession, for example?
Cash, you wanna take it?
Yeah. So I think we do see that the delay in acquisition is an important component. So for example, in the absence of licensing laws, some states have passed waiting periods, right? So more time to complete the background check and also a little bit of separation between the purchase and the time that someone can pick up a firearm from the licensed dealer. But when you look at waiting periods sort of versus licensing systems have greater impact. So I think it's not just the delay in and of itself, because while there are prohibiting conditions that are based on nonviolent offenses like drug and alcohol use, for example, there are people who are prohibited for violent offenses that we know may get missed in the system. So I think it's not just one particular component. I think it's these components working in conjunction.
Great, thank you. Next question, what does the research say about the fingerprint requirement specifically?
So this is a area where we're doing more work. One study in particular, we looked at county level firearm homicide and some of these policies. And we, because there are so many more counties than states, we were able to dice some of these elements together. And when you look at in-person applications with fingerprinting, that is the most effective form of a licensing law in terms of reducing firearm homicide. Part of it, I think, has to do with screening out people more effectively with the fingerprint-based background check. But you know, I'm sure we'll get into this a little bit more. There is reason to assume that being required to interact in person with law enforcement may deter people from purchasing firearms, both people who may be prohibited and also people who just might not want to interact with law enforcement, and that may reduce overall gun ownership. And we know that lower rates of gun ownership, we see lower rates of gun-related deaths. Daniel, I don't know if you want to add anything to that.
No, you nailed it.
Great. Let's go to the next question then. Let's see here. What would a federal handgun purchaser law look like, and what federal agency would be best equipped to manage a federal licensing scheme?
That's a great question and a difficult question. So licensing systems to date, of course, have been implemented at the local or state level. So the question is, could there be a federal agency that issues permits, does the vetting? And I think the answer is yes, but it would take some, it would take some investment of so that you would have offices ready to receive people coming in, because, most FBI offices or ATF offices These are not places where civilians just come in the door to do business. So we'd have to think about what that would look like. But I think it's clearly possible. And honestly, the process for applying to get a passport, for example, you can go to post offices. There's other places you can go. So there's actually some. Our group and some others are thinking through some of these issues. The other thing that the federal government could do, and there's actually legislation already been introduced in Congress, is to provide funding to incentivize and support states for implementing these kinds of laws. So there's different ways that the federal government can either directly do licensing, which again would take a little more time, or directly support localities or state agencies to do that.
Great, thank you. Next question is about default proceeds. How often does a gun buyer obtain a gun after a default proceed period and then be discovered to be prohibited?
So, go ahead.
I was gonna say, so for the prohibited side, ATF reports between 4 and 5,000 purchasers every year are identified as prohibited after a sale has gone forward. Now, I'm not aware of really good numbers that show the opposite, how many people were delayed that then were not prohibited. But I think while we certainly want to recognize that a delay is potentially impacting someone's right to acquire a firearm, I would argue that a little bit of a delay for someone who is not prohibited, that would then increase the likelihood that we could better identify people who are prohibited would be potentially a good trade-off.
I'm going to do a quick plug here actually for fingerprinting on this very point. Because if we had fingerprint verification of identity that we can link to criminal records, you would have far fewer of these situations that take a long time to determine the status and connect cases. I'm not saying they would go away completely, but I think that you would have fewer such cases because of ambiguities in trying to identify, making sure you're matching the right record with the right individual.
Great, thank you. Next question. How do you think about the very large effects you see of permit to purchase on suicide rates? How might we think through the ways in which these laws could affect suicide rates as substantially as they do, given how many people who purchase guns already own them, and given that most suicides are not among people likely to be deterred from buying a gun through a permit to purchase law?
Cass, you want to take that since you have an article on it?
Yeah, there are a couple of things here. So when we think about the way a licensing or a permit to purchase system works, we think about a couple of components, right? So there is the built-in waiting period, which can delay acquisition during a heightened time of crisis, which can impact suicide. There is the access to more records at the state level. So someone who has, for example, a mental health prohibiting condition may be more likely to be flagged. There's a lot of concern about HIPAA if you are uploading mental health records into the NIC system. Although as you saw from the graph at the beginning, it's either proceed, deny, or delay. There's no information provided about why. So that sort of HIPAA concern is not quite a valid one. The other thing that I think is really important to note, there's really new research out of California that has identified that the time shortly after acquiring a firearm dramatically increases people's risk of firearm suicide, which then can decline over time, that elevated risk. And so I do think that if you can intervene at the point of purchase, you know, separating in time and space someone from extraordinarily lethal means, you can see impacts on suicide. The last thing I'll say, firearms are extraordinarily lethal. And so even if someone was to substitute in a less lethal mean, they're far more likely to survive that suicide attempt. And so means really do matter. And so again, separating in time and space people from those really lethal means can have important impacts for suicide prevention.
Yeah, I'll just very briefly add that there's just so much research showing that availability of firearms is one of the strongest risk factors for completed suicide. And if you looked at the graphs from the synthetic control models, what you see is that when these laws change, the impacts grow with each year. So presumably what's going on is each year, in essence, there are transactions that are prevented because simply rather than an impulsive act that someone is despondent and they go out and buy a gun, if they have to stop and say, oh, you mean I've got to get training? Oh, you mean I need to go to law enforcement? Oh, I need to do this, this, and this. But that those delays provide, in essence, disincentives and opportunities. And again, people have suicidal impulses, sadly, frequently. So if you can have fewer guns, we're going to have fewer deaths.
Thank you. So for Pennsylvania and Maryland, do you see a lower percentage of crime guns originating from these states or a lower percentage of short time to crime guns after background check law implementation?
So if I followed the question correctly, the unfortunate part about those laws in the 1990s, those law changes, we do not have good longitudinal data from crime gun trace data to track in the way that we did with Missouri, in the way that we did with Maryland with those changes. So we really don't know. We have published, and actually others have also published, cross-sectional studies looking at the association between the presence of comprehensive background checks and the versions of guns for criminal use. We do see a correlation in somewhat lower rates for diversion of the same kind of metrics that Cass and I have showed in our slides on a cross-sectional basis. They give us less confidence than we do of seeing the temporal change, but there's some evidence that these laws are effective in, somewhat effective in diversion, but not quite as strong as with licensing.
Great, thank you. Another viewer asks, what should be done to make background checks more just? Criminal history records are rife with racial bias and poorly predict future violence.
Cass, would you, is it okay if I tackle this one? Since it's really a hard question, not that you couldn't answer a hard question, but honestly, this is a struggle. But basically, much of gun policy is based on some set of policies to identify individuals or time periods in which there's a high risk indicator. And we have to do that in some sort of reasonably efficient and objective way. Using criminal records has been the way that we have done that. So there is something called the Consortium for Risk-Based Firearm Policy. We grapple with these issues all the time and carefully consider the weight of the evidence. And we do see actually that violent criminal offending in particular and offending for alcohol-related offenses, particularly offenses that connect alcohol abuse to doing something really dangerous and reckless, like drunk driving. Those offenses are strongly correlated with future risks for violence. Same way with domestic violence prohibitors. But as the consortium has recognized and consistent with the data, for many people, those elevated times of elevated risk are not lifelong. So some of the prohibiting conditions are limited by law in statute. So it's not a lifetime prohibitor of being able to purchase a firearm. And I think that's something that both from a public safety and from a justice standpoint, we in firearm policy should be looking at more carefully. But I don't, I think I'm reluctant to say any policy that uses criminal justice records is going to be sort of off the table because there are racial biases throughout the system. I think that there would be public safety consequences to that. I think the way to address racial inequalities is to directly deal with those inequalities. And that's something, I mean, Cass and I and our colleagues have a report in Baltimore that sort of zeroed in on some of these kind of issues pertinent to fair enforcement of gun laws, and including considering diversion programs of that nature. So I think there's a variety of ways we in gun violence prevention should be and are focused on racial justice, but I'm reluctant to sort of just put off the table any policy that's going to rely upon criminal records at all, because again, there are predictive aspects of these offenses.
Great, thank you. And so actually a related question to that, another viewer asks, states handgun licensing scheme requirements vary widely, specifically with respect to discretionary elements such as propensity for violence or instability and similar criteria. Have there been any recent studies on the state discretionary criteria and their effectiveness in reducing homicides or suicides and the sort?
Cass, you want to take this, please?
Yeah, so discretion is sort of a tricky piece. Only a handful of states allow discretion in their issuing of purchaser licensing. It's more common, although still not exceedingly common, for concealed carry licensing. So we are concerned about some anecdotes we've heard about the ways in which discretion has been applied by law enforcement in different states. I know in the Q&A there was a question specifically about North Carolina. We've had experiences hearing how it may be applied in Massachusetts, for example. And so it's, in terms of the research pieces, we do know that when there is discretion in place, there are lower rates of gun violence. But the challenge is, are those laws being applied fairly? And our concern is that that answer is no. So that's something that we're working on right now. Daniel has mentioned a lot of us are thinking about this, and part of this thought includes, is there a way to, I know this is not exactly possible, but more objectively apply discretion based on potential dangerousness? So if we think about the example of an extreme risk protection order, right? There is a case that's presented where there is clearly articulated reasons for suspecting elevated risk that gets judged in court as to whether or not that is meets sort of sufficient standard to temporarily prohibit someone from gun ownership. And so we're in the process of thinking through how we might take some lessons from that process and apply it to permit to purchase or purchase licensing. So can we put into place a system that if states choose to have discretion that requires this clear articulation that people could then challenge if they didn't think they were being treated fairly? One thing I'll raise, I think it's unlikely, I imagine Daniel would agree, that new licensing laws that will go into place either federally or at the state level, it's highly unlikely that those states will have a discretionary aspect. I think that is probably the portion of a law that is most ripe for legal challenge. But we do know that even in the absence of discretion, these policies can be effective if you have the stronger background check system that's facilitated with a fingerprint.
Great, thank you. Speaking of red flag laws or extreme risk protection orders, another viewer asked, did your research consider extreme risk protection orders as an influence in the states that you discussed today?
Well, excuse me. We did note in Connecticut which had a law that was sort of a precursor, not exactly like Extreme Risk Protection Order, but in essence, it greatly expanded the ability when law enforcement were aware of an immediate risk, that it gave and empowered them to remove firearms under those circumstances. And we did, in essence, try to decouple, we did decouple the longitudinal part of our analysis, where that law was, in essence, ramped up in Connecticut. And so we saw that protective effects both before and after, but the protective effects grew, which suggests to us that there probably is some complementary effects of having both of these measures in place, both being laws that would lower gun availability to people in high-risk situations.
I would just add to Daniel's comment that for most of the other studies, because the vast majority of these extreme risk protection orders have been passed since 2016, they're either sort of too new to include or they fall outside of the study period, but obviously they'll be something that we keep in mind as we're moving forward.
And relatively few of those risk protection orders are connected to risk for homicide. They're much more common to suicide. So I think in our analyses, again, we're kind of geared right now to the suicide, their potential effects on suicide.
Great, thank you. Okay, we have time for just a couple more here. The question is, in Connecticut or Maryland, was law enforcement supportive during the legislative process? And have they since expressed publicly their support or appreciation regarding the resulting positive effects of the policies?
So honestly, you know, the law change in Connecticut dates some time ago. So I really don't know kind of the history of law enforcement being behind that. I was, of course, around in 2013 when Maryland adopted its licensing law. There was general support for law enforcement. I have to say that the way Maryland's law works, in essence, minimizes some of the challenges, administrative challenges for law enforcement, in that the fingerprinting is something that is done by state certified vendors rather than a law enforcement have to do it directly. So they were in essence at the table trying to come up with a workable system, an efficient system in Maryland.
I'll just add, a few years back, there was not the first time nor the last probably conversation in North Carolina about repealing their licensing law. And some of the sheriffs have actually put out a PSA in support of keeping the licensing law as a public safety measure. So we've seen that as well.
Great. Thank you. We weren't able to get to all of our questions today, but we were able to get through a lot of them. So thank you for submitting the questions, and thank you to Daniel and Cass for going through those. There was one question that we didn't have time for, but I just wanted to put a flag out for, because in the follow-up materials, we'll send some additional materials. The question was, have you studied terminology, licensing versus permit to purchase, which they suggest they're wondering which to use in especially gun-friendly states. And so I just throw that question on the table, because as part of the follow-up, we will send some materials that the Joyce Foundation, along with the Candida Fund, commissioned back in November of 2019, that looked at that very question and asked gun owners their views on that. So with that, thank you for joining us today. Again, as I mentioned, today's webinar was recorded, and we will make it available on our website in the coming days. And in addition, we will send around the slide deck from today and some of the other key materials that were referenced. And then finally, information about our next research-based webinar will be sent around in the coming weeks. So please be on the lookout for that. And with that, thank you again to our speakers, and thanks to all of you for joining us today. Thank you so much.